Hey everyone, in this video I'm going to do a quick demo on how to do topic modeling in R, specifically using latent Dirichlet allocation, or LDA, which is still one of the most popular topic modeling approaches being used. To be fair, there are many useful alternatives such as structural topic modeling, which you also have some tutorials, but in this video we'll mainly just start with the basics and work with LDA, which is always still a very good place to start, right? Now, this video is based on this tutorial. The link is also in the video description, and also we have several additional videos which go a bit more in depth, done by my colleague Wouter van Attenveld, which are more about what topic modeling is, what you would use it for, some more substantive. He will just really focus on the code to help you get started so that you can play around with it a bit and learn as you go. So what we'll start with is loading the packages. In this case, again, we're going to use Quantida, the text analysis parts, and in addition, we're going to use the topic models package, which is aptly named for a package that does topic modeling. And we call, of course, that you would need to install these first if you don't have them already. Now, first, the first part is just going to load in some data. That's this piece of code here. So here we're going to first create a corpus. But one thing, we're using the inaugural speeches data, so the inaugural speeches from US presidents, which is always a good data set to work with because it's free. Like free as in we don't have any issues with copyright. But for this corpus, which normally has like 58 documents or 58 speeches, well, for LDA we're going to need a bit more articles, and also these speeches are generally very long, contain many topics. So what we're first going to do is we're going to split this corpus into paragraphs. So now at least we have 1500-ish documents of, well, much shorter length, so they're all just paragraphs in these speeches. To be clear, for LDA, we generally mean, well, for topic modeling, you would generally need more articles. If you have more articles, there's, well, more stuff to learn from the data, you could say. And this is just a very small sample to work with. So the results of this model will also not be very good. It will also improve if you use larger data sets. But this is a good data set to toy around with, because otherwise topic modeling can take quite a time to perform. It's quite computationally intensive. So here what we're going to do is we're now going to create a document term matrix using the DFM function in Quantida, which stands for document feature matrix. We're using the corpus, we're going to do some basic pre-processing, we're going to remove punctuation, and we're going to remove stop words. And we're not actually going to apply stemming in this case. It's a good article actually about pre-processing on topic modeling. I'll add it to the description as well. And here we're also going to say, very importantly, we're going to remove all the words from our corpus which occurred less than 5 times. And the reason for that is that this greatly reduces the number of unique words in our document term matrix. So normally we would have 9,000 features, which isn't that much, but still. And once we've removed those rare terms, which only occur a few times, we only have 2,500 features. And this is especially important when you work with larger data sets, because as I said, topic modeling is quite computationally intensive. And especially when you start working with these well, larger data sets, it can make a huge difference if you just focus on the most important words in your data. Plus, the very rare terms aren't that important for topic modeling, because you're going to want to focus on the words that occur multiple times so that they can be correctly identified as being actually part of a topic. So now that we have created our document term matrix, we are first going to convert this one to a different format document term matrix. That might seem a bit silly, but it's just necessary because the topic models package does not work with the document feature matrix format used by Quantida. The Quantida has this convenient function convert to convert your document feature matrix to a different format. In this case, I think that's the format from the TM package, which was like a old school package for text analysis in R. See, we do the conversion. We here have actually a separate document term matrix. So you see this is a different format from Quantida, but in content wise, it's the same as the DFM, right? It's the same number of documents, same number of terms, and the same values in them. And this is actually just all of the data preparation. So we just get a corpus, create a document term matrix, remove some of the least frequent words, and then convert it to a format that we can use with the topic models package. And the next part is already just, well, training the LDA model. But before we do that, we need to discuss this set seed here. You might know of it, and if you don't, it's important to know at this point. So set seed means a seed for the random variable generation in R, which basically just means that if you run a random function after this, the results will be the same. And it's best to just show that. So say that we're going to draw a sample from 1 to 10. Just, well, randomly draw 10 numbers without replacement. And of course, if you do this multiple times, the results will always be different, right? Well, most of the times be different because it's random. But if you use a random seed just before it, the results will always be the same. This is a nice trick that you can use in any kind of codes that you have, which has some kind of random components, to make sure that the results will always be the same, which is often useful if you do an analysis, because then afterwards you can actually reproduce your results. So here we're going to set a seed 1 before we run the LDA model. And the reason for this, as discussed in the other video, is that LDA is a probabilistic topic model. So the results of this model will always be somewhat different. Hopefully not too different, but at least somewhat different. So yeah, how this function works, it's quite straightforward. You have the LDA function. The first argument is the document term matrix in this special format here. This just says that we're going to use GIP sampling. You don't need to know that, it's a bit technical, but just beware that this is often a good one to use when you're using the LDA function. And here with k is 10, we specify the number of topics. And that might seem a bit inconvenient. You actually need to specify yourself what the number of topics will be, which of course is something that you would more ideally learn from the data, right? That the computer tells you, well, this corpus has 10 different topics in it. But that's not so easy to do. And it's actually also quite some benefit in being able to specify the number of topics yourself. Also some other techniques for determining what a good number of topics is. But for now, just know that you do have to manually specify the exact number of topics, which in this case is 10. And then here you can specify some additional hyperparameters. So the alpha has a alpha parameter of the Dirichlet distribution. And in this case, this controls well, basically how spread out the topics per document are. So if alpha is higher, then you would find more mixtures of topics in documents, like each document might have 3 topics or 4. Whereas if you use a very low value of alpha, it's much sparser. So you would get 1 topic per document or maybe 2. Again, this is something we discuss in the substantive videos. Here we just focus on that you run it, and it's as simple as that. Now in this case, it will only take a few seconds, but normally if you have a lot of data, this can easily take a day or so. That's why we use a small data set. And you see now we've actually fit our model. And the next step, of course, is what we can do with this model. Let's first look at just how you can look at the terms per topic, because topics in a topic model are not, of course, like topics where the computer nicely gives a label saying this is economy news. It can do that. What it can do is it can group words together, which are, well, the most important, let's say, to those topics. So here you see that if you have this terms function and you just plug in the model that you fit, trained, and here you specify the number of terms that you want to see for each topic. So here for every topic, you see the first 5 words. You could also have looked at the first 10 words if you want. It doesn't matter. So you see, for instance, that it found several of these word clusters, and these clusters indicate then different topics in your data. Just to show you, this is actually the same, you do it yourself, terms M, 5, and you would get just a matrix with all these values per topic. So rows being the different words for every topic in the columns. Now, in this case, you actually don't really see some immediate patterns, I think. So let's see if we have some indications. So we have war, nations, peace. So that is some commonalities here. In general here, the idea is, and especially when you train on larger data sets where there's more data to learn from, you will see these more coherent kinds of topics. So for instance, we one of the videos also that I linked discuss a study that we did where we used all the news about nuclear energy from the New York Times from the 1940s till now or something. And there you really do see these more clear-cut topics. So like one topic which was really about accidents, one topic which was really about the Cold War, was really about research. So you would see based on these words what they are more or less about. Of course, we can do this slightly more nicely. Instead of just looking at words like this, it's somewhat nice to know a bit about how important each word was per topic. So instead of just looking at the position, so this is the rank, the most important, second important, third, also take into account some values to that. So that's actually what we're doing here. We just say, well, for one specific topic, let's actually look at the posterior distribution in a topic model to see what actual values the words have in this topic. Topic 6. Posterior M gets the posterior distributions from our data. So that's the distributions of documents over topics and words over words over topics. And in this case, we're going to look at the distribution of terms topic, where we look at the specific topic selected here. This is a matrix with terms where each row is a topic and each column is a term. And here we're going to look at the row 6 for topic 6, which just gives us a huge vector of words with all the values for this vector in topic 6. Now we're going to look at the highest values, so the top words here. So note that here we're sorting the data, sorting the data where we decrease, so the highest values are first. Then we're going to look at the head, so that's the first x number of observations, in this case the first 50. This gives us the 50 most high-ranking words. And then here we can do heads again for just looking at the first 6 of them. So this is the same thing that you see in the table, right? Well, actually, it's the same thing that you would see in the table that we use in this example. So topic 6, nations, US, every May, nation. It's the same as we get here. But this time we also have some values attached to them. And then this is one of these few cases where word clouds can actually be somewhat useful. So a nice way to then investigate what words are important in this topic would be just make a word cloud out of it. Can't really fit it nicely on the screen here because it has to be quite big to make this recording. But normally you would get a good readable word cloud. So this is just the main way of looking at the really the surface level stuff of your topic model. And I want to emphasize that it's that this isn't all you should look at. It's quite tempting, one might say. So you'd often also do see in studies that they just run a topic model. They look at these top words. Based on this, they determine some kind of label. So they say, well, this was clearly a war topic because it mentions war and peace. And this was clearly a topic about government. Like I said, normally this stuff is more easy to interpret because the topics would be better. But you shouldn't just only look at these top words because, I mean, we're humans. It's really easy to read into stuff. There's actually a great article called Reading Tea Leaves, I think, which is about how to validate topic models. And one of the things here is to not just look at these words and assign some kind of topic to them, but there's more stuff that we can look into. So one of the things, for instance, one of the big advantages of topic modeling is that it actually assigns these topics to documents. So you know that this document had a different topic from this document. And of course also, this topic was mainly present in that document. So in addition to just looking at the words, we can also look at, well, topic 6 might occur mainly in a certain set of articles, and then we can actually read these articles manually to see what these articles are about. And then you actually do see words properly in the context of their use. That's what we're doing next. Look at the topics per document. We have the following line of code, which is similar to what we just did, but here we use the posterior and then got the terms posterior and looked at the row for the topic. This time, let me just clean this mess up. This time, we're going to get a posterior, but we're going to get the topics matrix. And the topics matrix, the rows are documents and the columns are topics. In this case, we're going to again use topic 6 that we just made. And we're going to look at the documents and the document scores for this topic. And again, we're going to sort this decreasing so that we get a vector with the most the highest scoring documents for this topic. So it tells us these are the document IDs and our data where this topic was really prevalent. Actually, here we say that 95% of the documents is about this topic. If you want to interpret it a bit lightly. Now, of course, you want to read these articles themselves, so you want to go back to the data and actually see where these articles, to actually be able to read them. That's what we do here. We have the topic docs here, which is a named vector, meaning that we have values and each value has a name. See, what we're going to do is, well, let's give us the names because these are the names of the documents. And we're just interested in the first one. Since we sorted on decreasing, the first one is this one, the Roosevelt 16. So here we basically just say extract the name from the first one. It just tells us, well, now you have this value for the highest ranking document for this topic. And then from our corpus, just give us the one where the document name is this top document. And this just, well, as you would expect, just gives us the text of this document. So now we'll be able to also read this topic and actually see, well, this document and maybe read several of these documents from the top to get a bit more of a feel for what this topic really is about, to see what these documents have in common, to see what the topic of these documents is. Now, in addition, let's first just evaluate what we just saw. So these are the two main things that you would look at. So topic modeling basically gives you for every document, it shows you what topics occurred in that document. And every topic also has a distribution of words. So you want to look at both the distribution of words for each topic to interpret what it's about and look at the documents in which a topic occurs to see what the topic is about. And this is the part where your human interpretation comes in, right? Because the model just gives you these word clusters and these topics defines as rankings of words. And now as a researcher, you need to decide what these topics actually represent. So there's always still this interpretation layer to it. Now, let's say that we have this, we have these topics and we also investigated what they are about. So we might have found that we have some kind of topic where they really talk about war and peace. And now we want to investigate things like how does the usage of this topic differ for certain groups? So we might look over time, for instance, whether this topic was more dominant in certain years, whether they were more likely to talk about war and peace in certain time periods. We might also compare them between presidents, whether some topics were really something that some presidents talked about and other presidents did not. So that's what we're doing here. We're just going to use some of the metadata, the document variables that we have, and just tabulate them, in this case using a heat map, with the topic scores. So here we're going to say, this is actually a small trick that we need to use. Note that by using this convert function above, we create this other DTM. But a downside of this DTM is that it cannot store the document variables. So it no longer knows for each document who the president was, what the year was. We still have the data in the corpus and in the DFM because that's all the cool Contida stuff. But this one doesn't support this metadata. So here what we're going to do is we're going to match the rows from our DTM to the rows in our document feature matrix, so that we can then take the document variables from the document feature matrix on the positions of the rows in the DTM. Just to show you. Now we just have a data frame where each row matches a row in the document term matrix that we used to train our topic model. And then we can aggregate this. Here we just use a classic aggregate function from base R, I think, instead of the tidyverse approaches. If you want, you can try this stuff out yourself to see whether you actually see how you can do this in the tidyverse, but here this code at least works for now. We're going to aggregate the posterior scores for topics. So that's this huge matrix where rows are documents and columns are topics. And we're going to aggregate these rows by the precedence. And then we're going to take the mean value for these topic scores. This is harmless. And we're also going to add the president's name to our row names in this data. Notation. Again, this is one of these issues which just happens because I need to do this. My computer to record it, my Windows, my our screen just needs to be huge. Right, so now here you see the heat map, where here we see the topic numbers, so the first topic, the second topic, all the 10 topics, and here you see the names of the presidents. So you can actually see whether some presidents talked about more or less the same things. And you do see some things which you would expect here, right? So Obama, Trump, Clinton is more recent stuff. These guys talking about the same kinds of topic, apparently. So even though we didn't immediately see some structure in our data, you do actually see in the results that there is some kind of idea of topicality. It does recognize some sensical clusters. Actually, the one that we run here in the demo, you see this even more clearly, where you see these two clear blocks of the more recent presidents versus the older presidents. So it does recognize that these are more or less two groups, that the use of certain topics, that some topics were like from the older presidents and some from the newer presidents. So even though here we don't really immediately see some clear topicality going on, there is obviously something that it does right here. And as I promised, if you're going to use more data for this, you will see more pronounced topics and see more interpretable kind of topics that you can use. But for now, the main thing is just to take this code, play around with it a bit, and see what happens. Also, try to plug in your own data if you have, hopefully, especially if you have larger data sets, to see whether that works better. One final thing to close off with, which is just a nice visualization that you can make, but I won't do it here because it's hard to show the screen for that. If you just run this code, you create this nice topic, well, like a dashboard overview for topics. I'll just try and see whether I can actually show you the visualization. We're going to need the LDA vis package for visualizing our LDA model. This code you can just ignore. It does some fancy stuff, but it's not so important. It just rearranges this data so that we can create this LDA visualization. Ah, yes, and this is actually the thing it produces. It opens it in your browser. So you see the topics, how similar these topics are. And you can also see the terms per topic, which is basically the same as we saw before in the top 10 lists, but now more nicely ranked with the numbers side by side. So this is a useful tool to interpret your topic model a bit. But it doesn't show you, for instance, the full text. You need something different for that, which we also discussed in one of the tutorials. But yeah, this is something to also look into. It can create some pretty nice visualizations, and especially when you're working with larger topic models with more topics, it's nice to have some kind of like this helicopter view, overview of your topic model. So that's it. We just showed you some basic code to try some LDA topic modeling, so please go ahead and try it out and have fun with it.